So my name is Emily Holland. I'm the editor of Poet Lore, which is America's oldest poetry magazine, published in print here at the Writer Center twice a year. Please follow the link that's in the chat to check out our previous issues, subscribe to get our new issue, which will be launching next month. Super excited to have that come out. But I'm just really excited to welcome you to our virtual Craft Chat series, where we talk with writers a little less about what they wrote and a little more about how they wrote it. And tonight, our guest is Carlina Duan. Thank you for being here, Carlina. So excited to have you.
Thanks for having me. I'm so happy to be here.
And if you would just do us the honor of maybe reading a poem or two from your book, Alien Myths, which we'll be talking about today, and tell us a little bit about yourself and your writing to kind of kick off the night.
Sure. Yeah. So hi, everyone. I'm so happy to be here. Thank you so much, Emily. Thanks, Zach. This is just such an honor and a gift to spend my Wednesday evening with folks here in this chat. So I am going to be reading from Alien Myths. This is my second book of poems, which came out in this past spring of 2021. This is largely a book that sort of thinks through intergenerational history and the Chinese American archives, specifically my personal, familial, and kind of broader historical archive as a descendant of Chinese Americans living in the Midwest. So I will start off with a poem. Did you want me to read one, Emily, or two?
You could read one or two, yeah. Let's do two if you're done.
Great. I'll kick us off with a poem. The poem I'm gonna start with is called None on the Rooftops. And for those in the audience who've ever attended language school, I grew up going to Chinese school on Sundays. So this is kind of an homage to my Chinese school. None on the Rooftops. Chinese school, year 7, and Richard and Grant and Gloria and me all cheating on the midterm with the eraser. She writes one character on top, then passes it discreetly to me, and I pass to the others. Chain, shame. There are no Chinese gods on the rooftops, but if there were, they would not be shaped like dragons, nor carrying porcelain bowls of pears. I believe they would get a good laugh out of us with our sticky Dorito fingers and our inability to say their names. Oh, Chinese God, are you there? Are you smoking? Please hear me out. I am stupid and young and I like your necklace. I'm asking how come when Emily called me a Twinkie, I could only imagine sweet cream smacked between my thighs, could only godlessly swallow. How come when Emily called me a Twinkie, you didn't say anything about the blessed stuff like my nai-nai chasing a goose for me or how I learned to pickle cucumbers in a tin? Characters grew gummy wings in my throat and refused to flit. Oh, Chinese God, I have a fist. I wanted to be good at this. I wanted not to cheat, but to actually see you standing there in front of the blackboard, mouthing the proper characters for child, for forgive, for tame. So that's that first poem. Thank you all so much for listening. And so like I was saying, this book I think deals largely with thinking about archival history, but also largely about language. So I'm excited to kind of talk through the craft of that together with Emily, who is not the Emily in the poem, by the way. So I think I'll just read one more that's sort of thinking through linguistic violence. This poem thinks a lot about kind of linguistic power and also linguistic violence. This is a poem where if you are listening to it and you hear me kind of pause for a beat, you can imagine that there's sort of like a blank line on the page. And so I don't know if folks can see, but there will be various moments where I pause and you can just kind of imagine like a blank line on the page. So this is called, Do You Have a Grammatically Correct Response to the Question? And remember the time I stood at the intersection carrying my black suit of hair and the woman stopped in her shiny car, rolled down her window to scream something vulgar, something clinking inside her mouth, a word, a system of grammar flipped to fury, red, ripe, railing at me. For what? my body, my attention. Anger is often in response to a boundary crossed. What was that boundary? Where were my legs? Why did I stand there without a word, holding the straw in my ice cube drink as the liquid turned warm and illegible between these jaws? Slosh, slosh. The woman stopped in her shiny car. The woman stopped to scream. You, in her shiny car, at me. Who is the subject of this sentence? Who is the object? What is the verb? Standard English grammar dictates the proper tense. Do I care about the proper? She spat at me. She said a bad word, a string of words demarcating my body, hit by grammar, hit by a field of letters, hid behind a lump in my throat while my body remained my body. My lungs pulled up the hot July air. My hair remained parted to the side as I clasped the straw as I watched the tips of my feet, a body to be screamed at by a stranger. July, North American, a street. Which tense would you like to use to describe the incident above? The past, the future. I will eat leaves and pour vinaigrette slow and skinny. I will feed the low opal of my mouth. In times of distress, I will turn on the stove. Garlic will be fried in a river of yellow oil. I will eat my letters, crunchy and fat, angry and swollen, soft and slathered in old-fashioned oats, I will try to pull up the words. Hit me, she did. Hurt me, I am. Language, she did. The word, I am. Am not. On a North American street, on a hot July day, a woman stopped her car where I waited at an intersection to tell me I was a... On a North American street, on a hot July day, a woman stopped her car where I waited at an intersection to scream the word. Later, I wilted leaves in a hot pan. Later, I fed the story back to my mouth. Later, the syntax was rewound in a reel, set aside, and I composed a new body of Roman letters out of my body. I pulled up words from their waggling roots and raised them to touch the edges of a face, a page, to cure and hold and praise and wriggle and snap and sister and alive, amen, and alive, amen, then defy and defy and talk back. So those are those two poems. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you. Thank you for reading those. And Zach, thank you for throwing the link to the book in the chat. Please take a minute, purchase Alien Miss. You will not regret it. It is such a wonderful book, and I've just had such a great time getting to spend so much time and be so close to it over the past couple of weeks in preparation for our chat. So thank you for reading those two for us, Carlina. I definitely had questions related to both of those poems, but I think I'll just start with the question that I sent you first, just to get us on some even footing, and then maybe I'll jump around and not throw you off too much. But I always say that as poets, we're kind of in the business of noticing things, and we write what we notice and our obsessions. And with this being your second book under your belt, is there something that you do within your work, maybe consciously or unconsciously, that goes unnoticed by readers, or something like a habit, a craft element that you're aware of that seems to slip by people who read and review your work?
Yeah, thank you so much for asking that. I love that question. And I had to think really hard about it when I first read it, because I was like, I feel like I have so many attentive readers. But one thing that I know that is a habit for myself, oftentimes with endings in poems, and a lot within this book in particular, is that I was thinking a lot within Alien Miss about the idea of having a composite speaker, what it meant to kind of have a speaker in the poem who was made up of multiple selves and of multiple kind of both historical figures, but also, you know, my family members as well. And I found myself, as I would arrive to endings of poems, thinking a lot about kind of speakers finishing mid-action in the poem. And so I think a lot of the poems in this particular book will end on a verb. And that's not necessarily something that I've been told yet, although everyone in this room, now that you're reading this book, I'm sure I'm sure people will tell me. But I think I have a tendency in this book to sort of think about, you know, how do I actually close on in mid-action in a poem, and what might it mean to actually leave space for an unresolved ending, whether that's through a speaker who's like in the piece that I just read, kind of define, talk back, whether it feels kind of like a more an ending that's moving or shuffling towards action or agency, the speaker kind of claiming agency in some ways, or whether it's maybe a more unresolved action. I have a poem in the book about a character in the book, Baba, who's based off of my father. And in one of the poems, I think I end with Baba opening wide his mouth and taking a bite of a steak and sort of ending on a hyphen. But I think a lot about endings with this particular book, and there's so much that I was sort of wrestling with in this book, with ideas of finality and also the ways that multiple truths or multiple things can be true at the same time. And I think some of how I tried to reckon with that was through thinking about endings and what it meant to kind of close on verbs.
Yeah, wow, I love that. I love how there's a way that that extends the ending through syntax and through grammar, even if there is a period, that kind of ongoing action, which feels very intrinsic to kind of the other concern of the text, which was like language and what it means to use language, or as in the poem you just read, to do language or to have it be done to you, and that kind of that extension and movement through the pieces. And now I want to go through and look at all the endings and find the verbs, but that's great. A little scavenger hunt towards the end. I love that. I'm going to get distracted if I keep looking. but yeah, there are poems too that kind of either don't end in punctuation at all, or do end on kind of that M dash and extension there. And is that something that you thought of consciously as you organize the collection, you know, kind of balancing that movement, or was it kind of specific to each poem?
Yeah, I think that in terms of organizing the collection, I remember as I was putting it together, thinking a lot about like different kind of constellations, not necessarily in terms of verbs, but in terms of who the speakers were, and in terms of kind of where the hearts of each speaker were kind of located. And so the book itself, you know, it's divided into three sections. When I first, in an earlier draft, it was two sections, then it became five sections. And I was like, I have no idea what are numbers? I don't know how to section this. But in the end, I decided on three sections. And the first section of the book is called Alien Miss. And I think in a lot of those poems, thinking in particular about the Alien Miss poems, Alien Miss is kind of a figure, and so she's this kind of intergenerational speaker. And so I have multiple poems that are organized, like, you know, there's a poem Alien Miss, and there's Alien Miss at the immigration station, Alien Miss confronts the author. There's kind of a whole sequence of poems where this Alien Miss speaker is present. And I think for me, I was kind of organizing that section in particular, both in some ways chronologically, thinking about history and sort of how I was writing about the Chinese Exclusion Acts, I was writing about Angel Island, the immigration station, but also, as I said before, I was kind of organizing based on, yeah, where the kind of central questions and also the kind of emotive energies of the speakers were. And so I think that in terms of organizing the poems, it actually might have been less based on like flight and that mid-action, and possibly more focused on where the speakers were kind of, where they were kind of what kinds of questions they were actually wrestling with. And so I remember finally, you know, having my like piles of pages all printed out for thinking about organizing this piece. And I think I like even wrote on the titles of each poem. I was thinking about like, both timeline and then also just like joy poem? Like, is this a joy poem? You know, is this a rage poem? Is it like a combination of both? And I was really kind of focusing on how to kind of create this emotive energy that would sort of, in some ways, and maybe that is related to movement as well, but thinking about the different emotive movements that would happen throughout the course of the book. So possibly less focused on individual verbs in the poems and more focused on kind of the poems themselves as objects, thinking about flight.
Yeah, yeah, I definitely saw that kind of movement through each section and even that movement through time, but movement through speakers and kind of the concerns and the questions that are coming up. And I think that the way that each section talks to each other through the book, and as you move through the book, you start to notice more of these kind of repetitions and recurrences of images and things like that. You know, I was kind of keeping track of mentions of things like oranges or ink or blood. And then, of course, the focus on grammar and language. And can you just talk a little bit about that sort of repetition and how it relates to continuity and kind of meaning making throughout the narrative of the pieces in the collection itself?
Yeah, well, I think the first thing is that I'm such an obsessive, repetitive thinker. And so often the way that I work through questions is actually like different variations of rewriting the same thing. And you know, growing up, I was born in the US, but English was not my first language. And I think a lot of the ways that I trace my own kind of poetic, both playfulness, but also kind of the labor of language is there for me when I look back at my child self, sort of trying to make sense of, you know, even grammar exercises or vocabulary. So much of my early English education, I remember in schools, was focused on vocab. And so just kind of repeating over and over again, vocab, like, you know, a word and writing it down and kind of making that actual, the muscle movement of repeating a word over and over again as a child. Like, I remember very well. I actually remember rewriting the word Mississippi over and over and over again for a spelling test when I was in elementary school. And so I think when I trace that back into poetry, part of the work for me is actually thinking about within repetition, both what gets emphasized as you're repeating, but also what gets diminished over time if you're repeating over and over again. And then thinking about repetition too, there's this kind of foundational stitch work that can happen if you're creating this environment for a poem or environment for a series of poems, which I think I was trying to do, especially with the Alien Mist poems. Thinking about actually, you know, if I kind of hold space for something long enough, what kind of emerges after, you know, sometimes when, at least for me visually, when I see a word on a page that, you know, is like 20 times in a row, it kind of starts to disintegrate. Mm-hmm. And my imagination also starts to kind of wriggle in there, and, you know, Mississippi becomes like pie at the very end, or sip, or whatever. And I think that there are new ways of looking that can happen for me when I'm repeating something, whether it's, you know, an image in a poem, or whether it's something as simple as actually a word over and over again in a poem. I think I have a poem in this book where I repeat the word blood at the end of every line. And I think that poem in particular for me was a way of like reckoning with and holding enough space for a lot of difficult questions that I was having about like public allegiance, you know, and private allegiance and what it meant to like pledge blood to like a country. I was thinking a lot about that idea. And so I think that repetition becomes a kind of method, both in thought work for me, where I'm working through an idea, thinking about it over and over again in my mind, it starts to tessellate. So it starts off one way and it kind of slowly over time maybe shape shifts just a little bit. Mm-hmm. And when I reach the ending, there's something new or kind of delightful or terrifying for me there at the very end. And it also, I think, just in a very basic way, I think it's actually a way for me to actually think about language at its sort of very root core. And so, you know, repeating a word over and over again, like what are the different sonic pieces that get emphasized when you're repeating that word over and over again? And what are even words within words that I didn't even notice before? Or what are sounds of the words that I didn't notice before, but I had to notice because I repeated them multiple times? So I think that's where I'm at right now with repetition. And I'd love to talk more about it. Or
yeah, no, I think, I mean, there's so many things that you said that I feel like I'm similar in that when I think through things and when I write things, it comes out in a different way, but it'll be kind of circling around the same thing to the point where I'm like, did I already write this? Like, and it's kind of in another form and in a different kind of mishmash, and that kind of repetition begs transformation as you kind of keep ruminating on it. Yeah. And the same thing with words too. I'm thinking about how when you see the same word over and over, it starts to look like it's misspelled and you want to change it. And yeah. I think that, you know, that's that same kind of urge to transform something.
Right. And I think it goes back to what, you know, your earlier question or your earlier noticing, which I loved about like poets as paying attention to particular things in the world. And there is something that just on a very logistical level with repetition, repetition invites you literally to pay attention, and to sort of, I'm thinking about what you just said about the word becoming, you know, in your mind, is it misspelled? It has to be misspelled, that kind of transformation that occurs, or maybe is almost like forced to occur in the environment of a repetition.
Yeah. I love tracking repetition through things. So that was one of the joys of reading the book more than once, was getting things to jump out in different ways across poems. And that kind of flipping back, like, hey, I saw an image that was similar to this earlier. And, you know, how do they play off each other? And what does it mean to one speaker versus the next speaker? And that kind of transformation too, is really fun. I do want to remind everyone to put your questions in the chat. I do try to keep an eye on it, and we'll weave in as many questions as we can. I have plenty to fill the time, of course, but we love to hear your questions. So please throw them in the chat as they come to you. You mentioned the poem that ends, you know, each line ends with the word blood. And so I kind of wanted to talk about form a little bit, because that was another fun thing reading the book, was sort of stumbling across forms that I wasn't expecting to see. You know, the first poem is the huzzle with that couplet and line and word that repeats, you know, in each couplet. And then there's a sonnet, there's a golden shovel, which was really fun. And I was like, oh my gosh, it's in here. And I noticed the end words and I was like, okay, there's something going on. And so those are fun to jump out. And there's also kind of a Sistina-esque thing happening with some repetition of words in another poem. So could you just talk about your relationship to form and maybe any of the forms that you use specifically, you know, how you wanted to weave them into the book and what that was like in your writing process?
Totally. Yeah, I love form poems. And I for other writers in the room, I'm always also very curious about other folks' relationship to form, because I didn't start off loving form. I think as an earlier student of poetry, I really resisted form. And I think, you know, I think I had a lot of both misunderstandings, but also a kind of resistance to like the rigidity that I saw as a younger student of poetry in something like the sonnet. And I think, you know, it wasn't until I actually started reading, I think both contemporary and also older poets who were, I think, doing just really rigorous and rich work with pushing form. So I'm thinking about like Terence Hayes, who, you know, with thinking about the sonnet in particular, thinking about even Ada Limón and her sonnets as well. And I started for myself kind of noticing the ways that form invites this, you know, it invites you to actually sit within a series of questions as a form. And so thinking about something like the sonnet, which is 14 lines and, you know, can have that voltor, that attention to meter, it started providing a way, an entrance for me to actually write into questions that I think I was having a really difficult time with, particularly with the book Alien Myths. In Alien Myths, when I started writing these poems, I wanted to write about, like I said earlier, kind of the Chinese American archive. But I found myself questioning my own role within that archive and thinking a lot about, you know, for myself as a second generation American born Chinese person, why do I want to tell this story so badly? And I think in some ways, like, form actually provided me a way to start writing into that question, where I couldn't access it before. And then having something like, you know, and that broken sestina, you mentioned it used to be actually an actual sestina, and I broke it apart near the end because I felt like it wasn't working. But actually having some sort of guidelines, whether it was repeating, you know, N words with the huzzle, or whether it was through like the sonnet, I started thinking about form itself as a kind of argument, like form is making an argument within the actual structure. And so then, like, how do I create poems that either walk alongside the argument that form is making, or possibly challenge the argument that form is making? So I think, like, my favorite form is actually the golden shovel. So I'm really happy you brought it up. And for folks who are unfamiliar, this is also because I just taught the golden shovel to my sweet high school students a few weeks ago. It's a form, it's kind of like a poem within a poem, but it's inspired by Gwendolyn Brooks' We Real Cool, and just tracing the form of the golden shovel when you reach the last word of every line in a poem and you put those N words together, it makes up Gwendolyn Brooks' entire poem, We Real Cool. So invented by Terrence Hayes, very cool form. But I think that in itself, it's such a delightful form for me because, you know, given that fixed set of words that it has, like lurk, you know, die, soon, there's just so much tessellation or kind of shape shifting that I think for my poet's mind, I have to do in order to make those words work. And for the Alien Myths, for the manuscript, I was just thinking a lot about, again, like arriving and wrestling with those difficult questions, form as a way of kind of like startling myself into finding new responses, not necessarily final answers for those questions, but just different ways to respond. And I had a teacher in my grad program who like loved the sonnet. And so I also think that ended up becoming a part of my own kind of creative lineage with regard to just loving different forms, is thinking a lot about sonnets.
Yeah. There's also a way that I think received forms kind of put you in conversation with the other versions of those forms. And that relates to me to thinking about kind of the archive. You know, with using form, you're kind of relating to the archive of poetry in a similar way that you're kind of relating to the archive of Chinese American history here. And I wonder if you could, you know, talk a little bit about those early poems, the Alien Myths poems, and that kind of invented persona-esque speaker. But, you know, those poems also kind of retake some of the language of the Chinese Exclusion Act. So maybe, you know, what was it like to kind of repurpose that language of racism and violence in poems that are grappling with that very subject?
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Yeah. So in the Alien Myths poems, I was initially thinking a lot about the archive, which I think is such a huge word that I'm always like throwing around, and then I'm like, wait, back up, what is the archive? But I was thinking a lot about just this collection, this like historicized collection of both narratives and text and, you know, dialogue that I have felt like I've kind of both inherited culturally, and also in some ways as like a student of like American education. So when I began the book, it was actually questions that were sparked in my first book, I Wore My Blackest Hair, where I was a college student at the University of Michigan, and I was taking an Asian studies class, and my professor mentioned in passing Chinese exclusion.
I'd never heard the term Chinese exclusion before, and I think I was like 18 or 19 at the time. So I think I did naturally what like an 18-year-old would do. I think I Googled it. And then I found like a whole host of things. And so it was that kind of really weird experience of kind of having to like learn my body, like the history that I had directly descended from, but I had never been taught in a formal way, and sort of questioning like, why is that? And then stumbling into, you know, what it meant to kind of just work with and study like omissions from this collection of texts, whether that's again like documents or legal rhetoric, like from the Chinese Exclusion Act, like the actual legal text, or whether it's even from like, you know, cultural ideas of like Chinese America that I think existed in the public imaginary in the 1800s, that exist in the 2000s, that exist in like now, 2021. And so I was really interested in thinking about the poem as like a space for almost like a collage in some ways of thinking about what would happen if I actually contextualize this language in a different light. And what might happen if, you know, I take the transcript of the Chinese Exclusion Act and juxtapose it, or maybe put it against like a speaker who is, you know, part autobiographical. So thinking about myself, but who's also like part invented and based off of what I was reading at the time. And I was reading a lot of like history textbooks. I was reading a lot of like I said, kind of those legal transcripts. And I was reading scholarly articles and also just text messages from like my parents, where I was sort of asking them like, did you know about this? And I think that I was interested in the work of documentary poets in particular. So I was reading a lot of actually Muriel Rukeyser, and I was just reading Emily Jungmin Yoon's work, and just a lot of documentary poets who I think are also asking these active questions of what does it mean to return to a history and sort of think about what kinds of methods we've been taught or we've been given to think about a particular history, and then how I can kind of like dismantle that or sort of sit with that and maybe like prod that a little bit. So yeah, in terms of those early alien myth poems, I was doing a lot of like research, and I think that I wanted to like incorporate that as like material within the poem. So I used like text from the Angel Island Immigration Station website, which was hilarious. I used text that, you know, filled me with a lot of rage and was really hard to read. And I used like, you know, the Chinese Exclusion Act transcript. I was thinking about the page acts, and I also used like just dialogue, conversations that I had with colleagues and peers and close friends and family, and sort of was just thinking again about scaffolding all of that text together and what might happen, just placing things in proximity with each other that don't often get placed or were taught or shouldn't be put, you know, in dialogue with one another.
Yeah, almost like because the archive is so spread out and so disparate and such a patchwork on its own, you're pulling your own patchwork together and kind of creating a new entry. And I think that was really meaningful and a great way to start the collection, because it kind of gives a foundation through which to kind of see the rest of the collection unfold. In this way. So I definitely appreciated that sequencing and those poems right at the beginning, for sure. I wanted to touch a little bit more on research, because I think a lot of times, maybe culturally, we don't think of poems as being very research heavy. And, you know, we're like, you know, you write your feelings, and that, you know, that's the kind of cultural expectation or imagination of what a poet does. But I was reading an older interview that you did where you mentioned, you know, almost every poem having some sort of like Googled nugget of research. And obviously those alien myth poems have a little bit more of that component. So I wonder if you could just talk about research and your process. And even here in this book, we have the poem that uses like the image of the Google search as well. So maybe talking about that and what use research is to you and where it kind of comes in your process.
Yeah, I think that so much of the way that I was taught to think about research when I was younger was so, you know, institutional in some ways. And I think there are definitely ways where research has done harm, you know, in so many different cases. And so I think when I think about doing research for a poem, I think I always have to ask myself, you know, who am I accountable to as I'm like creating this poem? And why am I, you know, what kinds of, like, what are my kind of reasons or like motivations for actually like doing, like, look, like doing this research? And sometimes it's both curiosity and sometimes it's actually out of just like understanding and like not totally, you know, the story that I mentioned earlier as like as a college student, like just like not knowing my own history and wanting to understand more of that. But I think for me, I think that the poem is like, I think of it as just such a space or a possible space for reparative care and thinking about also like documenting and sort of, and it is like, you know, so often I think in the, you know, university space or maybe the academy, there is a way that the poem gets diluted into only an object that we like study and sort of analyze and dilute, or it gets put on this whole other side of the spectrum where your feeling's heavy and it's not rigorous and it's, you know, it's just my emotions, it's just my heart. And I think that I just want to like trouble that binary. I've seen like other poets, I think, trouble that binary a lot. And so research, I think for me, with the kinds of poems that I'm writing, which are very much rooted in sort of asking about questions about history, it's just such a crucial part of my process. And now when I do research, it's actually, I'm trying to pull from like a lot of different sources. So I'm not necessarily just looking at, you know, like a scholarly article about like Angel Island immigration station in like the 1880s and whatever. But it's also like I was talking about earlier with the earlier alien myth poems, it's also just thinking about reshaping my ideas of what research can be, because it's also conversation and you know, and I think the researcher as like a figure in the public imagination, even in my imagination, is someone who holds a lot of power and not necessarily always in for not always maybe the most accountable to that sense of power. And I think I really sit with that and sort of try and like honor my own questions that I might have about a particular moment in time or my own questions that I might even have about my community, but also think about it as I'm a participant in my space. And so sometimes like research maybe gets shifted a little bit into how do I actually just have the kinds of conversations that I'm interested in having with the people that I care deeply about in the spaces and the time that I live in, which are directly connected to the spaces and time that have come before me. So yeah, my process now is a lot of like reading. It's a lot of like listening. So I do a lot of, you know, like texting my mom or even just like listening to a podcast or even just like being out in public and like overhearing conversation. And I think it's also a lot of like seeing. So the research process is in a poem for me is also kind of just like what do I bear witness to? What is my body? Like, how's my body responding to a particular scene or a particular even excerpt from a piece of text? And so I don't think I necessarily view research as like maybe the traditional, like, you know, you've got to get your annotated notes out. But I think as a poet, we have a lot of agency and also a lot of power to kind of like be careful of using, but a lot of agency and creativity and thinking about what constitutes as research and how to kind of trouble those different binaries or islands that poetry gets placed into as like, it's just for analysis or it's just kind of feelings heavy. Yeah, the poem that you mentioned, Emily, the kind of the poem with the Google image was one that I was just looking up something like in the Google, as I do on Google, and that whole algorithm of, you know, the predicted Google responses came up, and I was like, how interesting. This is definitely a poetry prompt right here. And so I just kind of found myself writing into that.
Yeah, that's awesome. It's almost like, you know, you're kind of talking about maybe reframing research as also experience. And in that way, that research experience of seeing the Google, you know, predictive searches or most popular searches, whatever it does with all of its knowledge. But then it became a poem prompt. So it kind of, you know, it's almost like the snake eating its own tail, kind of feeding into itself, which is super cool.
Really?
And I'm always a fan of poems that are in collections that kind of insert different materials when you're not expecting them. And so when I got to, well, I have to say, I read the notes first because I read the notes and acknowledgments first, and then I go through. So I kind of knew that from the notes, I knew it was coming, but I think that it was really fun to see that surprise among the other kind of forms that you're using, because that is kind of maybe a new form that you created for this book, which was fun. And I did want to talk about the notes section a little bit. One, because I just love notes sections. I think that they're a place where, you know, more poetry can happen. And in yours, you kind of start it kind of talking through what we've talked about a little bit about the alien myths sections and what you're kind of working through and going through, you know, questions of inheritance and accountability. And then you say all errors and opinions of the sequence as well as throughout the book are my own. And I thought that was a very kind of vulnerable thing to put in the book. And it's kind of getting at, you know, what is truth? What are multiple truths and how do we carry that as poets? So can you just talk about, you know, what does truth mean to you in poetry, in your poetry? And what does that kind of responsibility of being a poet mean to you through your work?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love this question. Thanks for reading so carefully and for asking it. I think that my thought work around like truth within poetry is informed a lot by the poet Rita Dove. And I studied a lot of Rita Dove's work, just both, I guess, in school, but also kind of on my own, because I find her such an amazing poet who's constantly sort of asking a similar question of, you know, how do I carry multiple truths or multiple contradictions at the same time? And I read an interview that she did in the Iowa Review, and this must have been like years ago, and she was talking specifically about her book Thomas and Beulah, which was a part autobiographical book about based off of her grandparents. And I think she said something in that interview where she said, you know, I'm thinking about the difference between fact and essence in a poem. And in a poem, you know, a poem may be more concerned at times with the essence of something rather than the quote, the fact of something. And she used the example of, you know, in a poem about her grandparents, does it matter necessarily if the scarf that her grandmother had on was yellow or blue? Not really. What matters was like the essence that her grandmother was wearing that scarf. And so I think a lot about that as it relates to this book in particular, mostly because I think at a certain point I had to accept that, you know, I couldn't know everything that there was to know about specifically the history of Chinese exclusion, which I was interested in writing about. And even writing about like my familial relationships, like I can't know everything that there is to know as much as I would love to about, you know, even about like my familial history, that there are limitations for me as not just a poet, but also as a person, and that all of my poems, even if some of them are written through, you know, personas, they are filtered through me, Carlina, as like my own, with my own kind of like blind spots on. And so I think that I was interested in trying as best as I could to capture a kind of emotional essence and a kind of like historical essence as I was experiencing it, both through the research process and both through just the writing process and my reading process. But I also felt like, and it was important to me actually that some, you know, of the, a lot, most of the historical, all of the historical information was accurate. But I think, in terms of like the kind of emotive essence of the poems, that's what I was after in a lot of this book. I put that line there, all errors and opinions in this sequence as well as throughout the book are my own, because I think that I do feel actually really accountable to being like honest in my poetry. And I felt that I also recognize that, because this happened with my first book actually, where every piece that I wrote in this book, you know, I wrote between a certain number of years, and now it's 2021, it's, you know, and I knew that the person that I would become after this book may not necessarily agree with some of my former selves who are even writing these poems. And I think I had that line in there as also a way to kind of hold grace for myself in the future, and to kind of, you know, look back at this book, which I'm sure I will even next year or in a decade or who knows how long, and sort of like be like, really, I wrote that? Like, no, you know, but to really kind of, I wanted to be able to hold some grace for myself, to understand that this book was created in, and it was sort of a portrait of what I was thinking about and the questions that I was asking in the limited years that I was creating this book, and that my questions would continue to evolve beyond this book. And I'm sure a lot of my my knowledge even of what I'm writing about has already grown, I think, since the time this book was created. So I wanted to just be accountable to, I guess, both error, but also thinking about holding space for a future self who might look back at this book and sort of, you know, with quizzical eyebrows, and to say, this was something that I made and that I want to honor the self that created this book in the years that she was kind of making it.
Yeah, in a way that feels in relation to what we were talking about at the beginning with this kind of, you know, the multiplicity of the speakers being, you know, not just in one place or one time, and that kind of fluidity, but also extending that fluidity to yourself and knowing that maybe there's a future where you know, don't like the poems as much as you do now. And I think maybe we all have those moments with our own work too, but no, I think that's great, that kind of giving yourself grace in your own work is important for sure. And I wanted to talk about kind of the jump from first book to second book, because you mentioned your first book, and I feel like there's always pressure on that second book or a second album, you know, is it, you know, sophomore slump, and how do you, you know, kind of navigate writing new things, but you have kind of a solid foundation already. And so could you talk about, you know, what it was like to go from first to second book? You know, how is this book a continuation of that first book, or how is it totally different? And then we can kind of talk about the publishing aspect too.
Yeah, sure. So my first book came out in 2017, and it was called I Wore My Blackest Hair. And I think I have like kind of a funny experience with the first book, because I wrote all of it when I was a college student. So I wrote all of it between the ages of probably like 19 to maybe 21 or 22. And so much of my earlier questions, which were actually kind of, I think, setting the stage in some ways for some of the questions that I wrote about in Alien Mist. But I was having those like initial questions, maybe shadow questions, about like, what history have I descended from, and how have I been sort of taught this selective history, and how am I sort of creating or crafting or writing my own way back into this history. I was thinking about that, but maybe in more personal ways. Like, I think a lot of my responses to thinking about, like, for example, like a national history was actually writing about it almost exclusively through the self. And I think that in Alien Myths, it's both rooted, those questions are rooted within myself, but they're also rooted maybe more on a community. And so I think there's maybe more of a communal aspect to Alien Myths and thinking about even like my own lineage of like my grandmothers, my great grandmothers, my great, great, greats, and also who I've woven into my own creative lineage, both in terms of like, you know, Chinese folk singers and my grandmother and, you know, Claire Chan Rui Lee, who was like the first Chinese American woman to ever vote, but thinking about who I choose to have in my lineage. I think that Alien Myths did a little bit more of maybe like communal exploring and exploring through this kind of chorus voice that in I Wore My Blackest Hair, a lot of my speakers, almost all my speakers, I think were really just an individual. We're really just me. And so, yeah, the kind of transition from the first book to the second has been really interesting because I actually look back at that first book and sort of like what I was talking about earlier. I think that there are parts of me that looks back at like my 18-year-old self and is like, wow, this is in print in the world. But then I think it is a part of that project of both having grace, but also even observing that there are some, we were talking about repetitions earlier, there's even just some like obsessions that I've had, like even in image work, like the image of food and fish, like that has followed me, that has chased me throughout my career so far as a writer. And I'll be interested to see kind of what happens, you know, next. But I think it's always really interesting to kind of look back and see where those former shadows of the kind of current obsessions like grew from. And so the first book I really see as a sort of maybe baby blueprint for actually what Alien Myths became. I didn't really do as much research in my first book either is what I'll say. A lot of those poems were from, or maybe in the traditional sense of research, a lot of those poems were rooted in kind of personal experience.
Yeah, I had a professor who always said that we always kind of lead into our next project with the current project. Like there's always something in there that's kind of like hinting at the work that will come. And I think that between first and second books is a great way to kind of tease out those obsessions that you can't quite shake off and kind of track those down. And with publishing, I know your first book was published with Little A, and then this book was published with University of Wisconsin Press, which is a university press. So could you talk about those two publishing processes and kind of what that was like for you with the manuscripts and things?
Totally, yes. So so both the books were actually picked up through contests. And so that was kind of interesting because my experiences of both presses have been in some ways different and in some ways, I guess, similar. but so with Little A, I think I worked a lot more closely with Little A with an actual editorial team who was specifically, I was working with Morgan Parker and then Vivian Lee. And so those were kind of the two eyes that I had on the actual lines of the book. And they gave me really formative feedback on the entire process. And it was, you know, I had had a manuscript that I submitted to a contest and it didn't win, but it was a finalist. And so Morgan, who at the time was one of the editors for that press, decided that she wanted to publish like one more manuscript out of that contest. And so she chose mine, which was such a joy and a delight to kind of get to work with her and Vivian. And so they actually read the manuscript read many drafts of the manuscript and they offered pretty, very attentive, kind of editorial feedback. Actually, one of the really like most interesting decisions that I made in that first book was to move what was then the last poem in the manuscript to the first poem of the manuscript. And that was actually a decision that was influenced by conversations with Morgan. And so I felt like I actually worked very, very closely with like a team of editors. And Little A was more kind of a I think, you know, they're more of a commercial press. And so they had a marketing team, just like kind of a lot of collectives of people that I was working with. With the University of Wisconsin, I submitted to the Brittingham and Felix Pollack Prize. And so my manuscript, again, did not win, but was like a finalist. And so the editors decided to publish it, which was also very exciting. My editorial feedback process was a little different with the university press. So I actually got most of my editorial feedback from kind of close trusted readers and friends, rather than working with the editors themselves. But I also felt like I, in some ways, had some more flexibility in that way to kind of work within the manuscript and even with the cover, which was really interesting. I got to kind of commission a friend and collaborator to help me with the cover art. And I felt like I had some more agency over actual aesthetic decisions with working with University of Wisconsin. So both processes were really informative and really wonderful and interesting. And I think that, yeah, with the University of Wisconsin Press, that it was great because I also got to work with individuals rather than like a team. So I felt like I got to kind of know the individuals who were like copy editing my book and you know, helping give like cover art like final advice, and so that was pretty exciting as well.
Yeah, I love that. I think the cover, just to flash it up again, I think it's beautiful, and I always love when poetry books feel like art objects as well. And I think that, you know, this one, I mean, it totally does, and it you know, has great dimensions to allow for some of your longer lines. And I think that is the intentionality of the design is very obvious. And I'm glad that you were able to have some input with that.
Thank you.
So we're nearing the end. I don't see any questions in the chat, but if anyone has like a last minute thing, throw it in there. But Carlina, I was wondering if you have any kind of craft advice that you always turn to, or just something that you tell your students that would be kind of your go-to craft thing.
I think something I'm working on with myself right now is to really like paying close attention and listening when I even get a whispering that a poem is coming, because I think so often, in at least in my world right now, you know, a poem might whisper to me and I might choose to say like, oh, I'll come back to it later. And I never come back to it. You know, the world just kind of buzzes on. And so I think that with a lot of the poems in this particular collection, I think I was at a place in my kind of personal world also where I was able to kind of just be able to like listen in on those whisperings and to actually honor them. And I think give them the time and attention that in some ways I hope they deserve. And so I would just encourage folks, well, first that I'm so, again, excited to read the other writers in this Zoom space right now. And also to encourage folks to kind of like hear those whisperings and like really honor them and pay attention to them. So thank you, Emily, for the brilliant questions. It was such an honor to be in conversation with you. And I feel so lucky to have you as a reader of this work. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you. And thank you for your poems and for your time. Getting a lot of shout outs in the chat for all of your generous responses. And this is so great. These are kind of my favorite part of my week is doing these craft chats and diving into the poems. So I'm so glad that we were able to have you as our guest.
Thanks, everyone.